Bibliophiles of the internet, as I'm sure you've noticed, September is over and done with. The wrap-up is officially done and dusted, which means it's finally time to chat about my third quarter reading stats. I've loved doing these quarterly stats videos every few months and getting a chance to step back and reflect on what I've been reading, how much I've been reading, etc., and I'm really glad that y'all are enjoying them as well. Some people have asked me how I keep track of all this stuff, how I calculate everything. I'm mostly referencing the data in my reading spreadsheet, which is an incredibly detailed template that I purchased from another bookish creator. If I can find the exact listing for the one I bought this year, I will link it down below. I also referenced StoryGraph for some additional information, and both of those sources will calculate a few things for you up to a certain point, but the rest is just math and analysis I've done for myself, because I do happen to have a little bit of a math background, not to brag. Starting, as always, with the big picture, in the third quarter I read a whopping 28 books. It's especially significant when we look at the monthly breakdowns, which I'm going to take you through in a second, because July was far and away the lightest reading month I've had all year long. And even taking that into consideration, I still read more books in this quarter than the previous two, which is kind of wild. In July, I read 6 books. Those books were The Spear Cuts Through Water by Simon Jimenez, Otherworldly by F.T. Lukens, The Loudest Silence by Sidney Langford, The Eyes Are the Best Part by Monica Kim, The Seventh Veil of Salome by Silvia Moreno Garcia, and The Emperor and the Endless Palace by Justinian Huang. In August, I read 10 books. Those were When the World Tips Over by Jandy Nelson, The Truth According to Ember by Danica Nava, Libertad by Bessie Flores Salivar, If We Were Villains by M.L. Rio, The Palace of Eros by Quero de Robertis, Cursed Bread by Sophie McIntosh, The Cue by Basma Abdel Aziz, This Dark Descent by Kaylin Josephson, A Bond Me for Two by Trinity Nguyen, and Prince of the Palisades by Julian Winters. And in September, I read 12 books. Those were Just for the Summer by Abby Jimenez, I'll Have What He's Having by Adib Karam, The Night Guest by Hildur Notstadter, A Master of Gin by P. Jelly Clark, Compound Fracture by Andrew Joseph White, Where the Dark Stands Still by A.B. Poronek, Lightning in Her Hands by Raquel Vasquez Gilliland, The Bright Sword by Lev Grossman, Vespertine by Margaret Rogerson, The Devil Takes You Home by Gavino Iglesias, Graveyard Shift by M.L. Rio, and Model Home by Rivers Solomon. I haven't done this stat in the previous two videos, but because I read so much this quarter, I really wanted to know how many pages I read, and after adding everything up, I learned that I read 8,926 pages. With that said, let's move on to talking about reading trends, starting with my top three most read genres. For the third quarter, my top three genres in ascending order were, oddly enough, mystery thriller coming in for the first time at 5 books, romance coming in at 6 books, and unsurprisingly, fantasy dominated the charts at 9 books. Again, we have to acknowledge that there's some complexity unaccounted for in those numbers. Some books can comfortably fit into more than one genre or can be argued in different ways. There's also important subgenre categories that are also not accounted for. It's not a perfect system, but it is the system I have. Compared to the first two quarters, fantasy and romance have consistently remained two of the top genres for all three quarters so far, so I obviously have no aversions to those genres, but I just think it's interesting because I don't consider myself to be a fantasy reader or a romance reader. I just consider myself to be someone who reads a little bit of everything, but the numbers are the numbers. Historical fiction was a frontrunner in the first quarter but dropped out by the second. The second quarter was the first and so far only appearance of horror as a top genre, and now for the third quarter in a row, my third wildcard spot goes to a completely new genre, which is mystery thriller in this case. Last quarter, I introduced a new stat that I called How Many Were Queer, in which I calculate how many books I read in the last quarter were queer books. By my count, this past quarter, I read 17 queer books, which means out of 28 books total, roughly 61% of the books I read were queer books. There's been an interesting trend with that percentage. The first quarter, 48% of the books I read were queer, then second quarter, it skyrocketed to 72%, and like I said, this quarter, it's at about 61%. That's also interesting to think about. I don't think there's any real rhyme or reason to it. I'm always gonna gravitate towards queer books, and the numbers definitely prove that. Pride Month does take place in the second quarter, so that might be a contributing factor, but either way, queer books being more than half of my quarterly reading absolutely checks out. Now let's talk about reading format, as always going from least read to most read. I have a slightly shameful confession this quarter because I have to say that my least read format was ebooks, coming in at 0 books. If you want to split hairs and get technical, it's maybe 0.3 books because I started When the World Tips Over as an ebook and finished it as a physical book, but I would say that was more supplementary than anything else. I'm about to blow your mind because my second most read format, not my first, my second, was audiobooks. In the third quarter, I read 12 books as audiobooks. That is roughly 43% of my third quarter reading. I'm really neither for or against this difference. I love audiobooks. They're always going to be one of the first formats I reach for. I just think it's notable because in the first two quarters, audiobooks absolutely dominated the format category and came in at the top for two quarters in a row. And now it's been dethroned by the unlikeliest of contenders. That's right. In the third quarter, the tried and true physical book finally came through and took the top read spot for the first time all year, coming in at a whopping 16 books, which is roughly 57% of my third quarter reading. If you've been following these quarterly stats videos from the very beginning, you know how freaking wild of a comeback that is. In the first quarter, I read 3 physical books. Second quarter, I read 7 physical books. Third quarter, I read 16. The numbers are rock solid, but it does not make sense. Again, I think it's just really interesting to think about because I love audiobooks, not only from an enjoyment and entertainment standpoint, but because in terms of accessibility, they've been the easiest for my brain to engage with and process for so much of this year. So to really hit my stride with physical books again and feel like I've figured out how to read and enjoy those again is just a really beautiful thing. It doesn't change my love for audiobooks, obviously. I think they're gonna stay as one of my most read formats for the entire year, but again, it's just an absolutely unprecedented comeback for physical books, and I'm so proud of us. Moving on, let's talk about audience spread, by which I mean the age range or age demographic the books I'm reading are targeted towards. For me, that's usually 3 main categories of middle grade, young adult, or adult books. Again, I have to kick this off with a very shameful confession, which is that in the third quarter, I read 0 middle grade books. To be clear, I'm not putting myself down or putting a value judgment on that in any way. I just think it's worth noting for myself because I do genuinely love middle grade books, and for some reason this year they've consistently been my least read demographic. I think I read 2 in the first quarter and 1 in the second quarter. So unfortunately, it's been a consistent downward trend, and I wish it wasn't. I wish I had time to read all the things. Coming in second place is young adult books. In the third quarter, I read 10 YA books, which makes up about 36% of my reading. And for the third quarter in a row, my most read demographic is adult books, coming in at 18 books total, which breaks down to 64% of my third quarter reading. Across all 3 quarters so far, the rankings for the audience spreads I'm reading have stayed the same, with middle grade being the least read, YA in the middle, and adult absolutely dominating with the most books. So at least I'm consistent. I read some real chonkers this quarter, so let's talk about book length, starting with the longest audiobook I read this quarter. My honorable mention goes to The Spear Cuts Through Water, a sensational audiobook I highly recommend, read by Joel de la Fuente, which comes in at just over 17 hours. When I started this quarter, I was convinced that nothing would top that, but then The Bright Sword came along and said, hold my purse, because I am 23 brilliant hours long. I absolutely love this audiobook, can't say enough good things about it. It is worth every single second of Nicholas Guy Smith's incredible performance, and I enjoyed every moment I spent with it. The longest book I read in terms of page count, regardless of the format, that was also, unsurprisingly, The Bright Sword by Lev Grossman, which is 673 pages. The second longest book was When the World Tips Over at 528 pages, and the third longest was The Spear Cuts Through Water at 522 pages. Can we really think about that for a second? Because I will die on this hill of When the World Tips Over being way too freaking long, because why is a contemporary YA book longer than an epic fantasy? That is wild. Jandy, I love you, but you do not need that much space. And to be fair, there's differences in printing, binding, text density, margin spaces, and all that stuff, but the point still stands. Even though I didn't have a ton of repeat authors this quarter, I did want to briefly mention that my most read author of the third quarter was ML Rio. I read 2, which in this case means all, of her books, If We Were Villains and Graveyard Shift. And even though that's not a super significant factoid or statistic, I think it is interesting in that it reveals that I read 26 other unique titles, which for me, as a proudly eclectic reader, is a really great thing. In terms of star rating, my average star rating for the third quarter was about 4.2 stars. That's ever so slightly up from last quarter, about 0.07 stars, which I think is great. You know, enjoying the books you read, at least for me, is a huge part of the point, if not entirely the point. Interestingly enough, I had the same amount of 5-star reads in the third quarter as compared to the the second quarter, which was 4 5-star books apiece. So I think that definitely helps to keep that average respectably high. Last quarter was the first time I started looking into my most read publishers, which I think is a very good statistic to know. It's good to know which publishers, companies, and corporations are getting our time, energy, dollars, and engagement. Not every publisher I read from will be represented in these numbers. I'm only looking at the highest read top three categories. Get ready for the tables to turn in a major way once again compared to last quarter. Coming in at third most read is Simon & Schuster, who did not feature in the top three last quarter. I read 4 books from Simon & Schuster imprints. Being dethroned from last quarter and coming in second place is Macmillan. I read 7 books from Macmillan imprints. And making a huge comeback this quarter is none other than Penguin Random House. I read a whopping 11 books from Penguin imprints. Again, I just love the fluctuation because Penguin Random House was my third most read publisher last quarter, barely making the cut with 3 books read from their imprints. And I remember putting those numbers together and being like, huh, that's weird. I thought it'd be higher. And alas, now it is. As a quick note, I will say that yes, I'm counting Compound Fracture as being from Penguin because even though it's published by Peachtree, they are distributed by Penguin Random House, and also the format I read, which was the audiobook, is produced, owned, sold, and distributed by Penguin Random House. Carrying over another new category from last quarter, let's talk about how many books I read from new-to-me authors. In the third quarter, I read 16 books from new-to-me authors, which made up roughly 57% of my reading, so more than half. Breaking that down a little bit further, 7 of those 16 books were authors' debut titles. Those were The Loudest Silence, The Eyes of the Best Part, The Emperor and the Endless Palace, The Truth According to Ember, Libertad, A Bond Me for Two, and Where the Dark Stands Still. Which means 9 of those 16 books were from new-to-me authors who may have published other things before, but I was reading them for the first time. That includes ML Rio, Sophie McIntosh, Kaylin Josephson, Basma Abdel Aziz, Lev Grossman, Abby Jimenez, Hildur Knutsdotter, Gavino Iglesias, and Margaret Rogerson. And again, the flip side of that statistic reveals something interesting because it means a decent chunk of my third quarter reading was from repeat authors I had read from before, which is also important to me because when I really appreciate an author's work, I want to make sure I'm returning to their new work. This past quarter, I read 12 books from repeat authors, and those include some of my all-time favorite authors like Silvia Moreno Garcia, Simon Jimenez, P. Jelly Clark, Adib Karam, Julian Winters, River Solomon, and Andrew Joseph White, just to name a few. Last quarter, I also started sharing which book cover colors were most prevalent or popular in my quarterly reading, and I definitely want to keep that going. This is such a nothing stat, but it's so much fun to look at, so I'm actually going to share the top 2, which doesn't sound like a lot, but you're going to see that it's actually pretty wild. The second most prevalent cover color is a 3-way tie between red, yellow, and pink, which each had 2 books. And the top cover color of the quarter is disputed in a 4-way tie between black, purple, blue, and green, which all came in at 5 books apiece. Before anyone gets too excited, yes, some of these might be debatable, but this tracker in my spreadsheet doesn't really allow for a lot of nuance. Obviously, a lot of book cover designs are multicolored, but I can only choose one simple color from the drop-down menu when I'm inputting these books, and I'm just making the best judgment call I can make in the moment. Penultimately, let's check out how much money I saved by using my library this quarter. As I always say, I love my library. I use it as often as I can in so many different ways. It's an incredible resource that I do not take for granted, and I did check out more this quarter than last quarter, which I think is great. This quarter, I checked out 3 physical books, 2 audiobooks, and 1 ebook for a total of 6 checkouts. As always, I am very precise in tracking the exact list price of the formats I check out, so all in all, by using my local library, I saved a grand total of $143.65. That's almost $50 more than last quarter, which is kind of wild. And in total, I've saved $388.18 by using my library in 2024. I feel great about that. Some people use their library far more often and save much more than that on a monthly or yearly basis, but as I always say, in this economy, I'm not gonna swipe my nose at saving almost $400 across 9 months. And as always, to round out this video, we're gonna talk about my top 5 favorite books from the third quarter. I read some really amazing things this past quarter, so this was a really tough choice. Going in chronological chronological order, we have to, of course, start with The Spear Cuts Through Water by Simon Jimenez. I'm going to keep the synopses pretty tight, but this is a queer epic fantasy written in such a way that it mimics the oral tradition of storytelling. It's about two warriors who are guiding an ancient god across a deeply broken kingdom in hopes of finally freeing the people from generations of tyranny and suffering. I spiritually, mentally, physically cannot tell you how amazing this book is. I'm sure you've heard tons of great things about it and incredibly high praise, and I can assure you that it's even better than whatever you think it is. And while the story is exploring a lot of different things, I just really resonate with its core message about being unafraid to fight for the future, even if that future is uncertain or imperfect. I feel like that's what the story is really about, the importance of moving forward and learning from the past so that we can create better futures. And even if those future possibilities may not be the ideal version of what we hoped for, they're still worth fighting for. Next, and I assume surprising no one, is The Palace of Eros by Gero de Robertis. This is a deeply evocative Greek myth retelling focused on Psyche and Eros. Psyche is a mortal woman whose beauty deeply enrages the goddess Aphrodite, which ultimately leads Psyche's family to tie her to a rock upon a cliff face and abandon her to die as retribution for this offense. However, she doesn't die. She's rescued by a non-binary deity known as Eros, who whisks her away to this magical palace far from the eyes of humans and gods. Gero de Robertis is one of my favorite authors, and even though this book is so different from the kinds of stories they usually tell, it just feels like they were always meant to write this. As I said in my August wrap-up, I just think this is such a beautiful book devoted to the wonder and necessity of self-discovery and self-invention. It's just a testimony to the power of queerness, the ability to see a world that doesn't fit who you are, and then dare to imagine and create a new one that does. It's a truly incredible story that's written to perfection. The audiobook is also read by the author themselves, and I think it's a great homage to the tone and style of the story. I just can't say enough good things. Next is If We Were Villains by M.L. Rio. This is like a beloved cult classic. It's a mixture of dark academia, mystery, and thriller about these 7 fourth-year Shakespearean actors studying at an elite conservatory for the arts. Because their acting program is so small and specific, they've all basically gotten used to being cast for the same kinds of parts. But when the cast list for their next production gets a major shakeup, it brings some unspoken tension and paranoia to the surface, which spills over from the stage to the real world when one of them is found dead. I do have to admit that I'm mostly including this one in my top 5, not just because I enjoyed the story itself, but because of the reading experience. I buddy read this with a group of friends, which is always a good time, and this story just hits so many of our niche interests in the most delicious ways. So getting to talk about it with them in real time and having that collective experience just gives it a really special place in my heart. But I also happen to think it's a tremendously smart and well-crafted mystery story that keeps the reader on edge the entire way through. And I think it's a great exploration of the different ways we use art, academia, and pretense as a way to distance ourselves from the world around us, and how dangerous that isolation can be. Then, of course, nothing in this top 5 would hold true if it did not include A Master of Gin by P. Jelly Clark. This is so far P. Jelly Clark's first and only full-length adult fantasy novel. It's a historical steampunk murder mystery following investigator Fatma El-Shawari, who works for the Ministry of Alchemy, Enchantments, and Supernatural Entities. The ministry was founded because the veil between the human world and supernatural world was cracked open by a man named Al-Jahiz. And now, many decades after his mysterious disappearance, it seems as though Al-Jahiz has returned when an entire secret brotherhood dedicated to his legacy is brutally murdered, and the killer claims to be Al-Jahiz risen again to claim righteous vengeance against modern-day Cairo for its many injustices. This is the third quarter in a row where a P. Jelly Clark book has been in the top 5 of the quarter, so I guess I gotta read even more from him to see if we can't make it a year-long sweep. Again, if you've been following my reading this year, the year that I proclaim to be the year of P. Jelly Clark, this should not be a surprise. The mystery element is so well thought out, perfectly paced, meticulously crafted, and with the space he has in this full-length novel, P. Jelly Clark is also able to really explore this fascinating steampunk world and interrogate the consequences of humans living alongside supernatural creatures. But like I said recently in my September wrap-up, it's the thematic messages that P. Jelly Clark is able to bring to the forefront through his use of genre fiction that really blows me away. This book has so much to say about how our expectations and assumptions shape the way we see and experience the world, how our brains are conditioned to reinforce the things we already believe, and therefore how incredibly necessary it is to consciously step outside of those self-made expectations if we want to fully experience everything the world has to offer us. Lastly, and again mostly for vibes and experience, I couldn't not include The Bright Sword by Lev Grossman. This is an epic Arthurian fantasy that manages to be both satirical and fervently earnest at the same time. It's about a young aspiring knight named Colum who's finally journeying to Camelot so he can put in his bid to become a knight of the Round Table. But when he finally arrives, he learns that he's too late because King Arthur tragically died in battle 2 weeks before, leaving behind no heir, no plan of succession, and only a handful of not-so-famous knights. So Colum and this ragtag crew of knights end up going on an erratic, desperate quest to somehow find a new king and hopefully rebuild their beloved Camelot. I'm honestly kind of mad about how good this book is. Like I talked about in my last wrap-up, I just feel such fondness towards the story and the characters because of how I consumed the story over a very long period of time. It was always so much fun to return to, and I just think it's such a clever twist on a classic Arthurian quest. All at once, it's a deeply silly and ridiculous tale about these nobodies of the Round Table having absolutely no idea what they're doing or where they're meant to go, and it's also a powerful story about reckoning with the consequences of empire and idolatry once you're left standing in the ruins. The story is openly asking whether these knights should be trying to rebuild Camelot, should be trying to recreate this violent colonial empire exactly the way it was in the first place, or should they be brave enough to try and discover what comes next? Overall, the story is just a beautiful ode to the fact that the greatest adventure any of us can ever have is simply doing the hard thing of moving on and moving forward. I just had such an unforgettable experience reading this. The audiobook is incredible as well. I highly recommend that format. And again, to not include this in my top five, despite its minor flaws, would simply have been disingenuous. Again, this was a really great quarter for reading, and I have to give honorable mentions to Libertad, Prince of the Palisades, Compound Fracture, Where the Dark Stands Still, and Model Home, just to name a few, which were all absolutely sensational in their own right. So those are all my standouts and reading stats from the third quarter. I hope you found this interesting. If there is a stat you would like to see me incorporate next time, let me know, or feel free to share your own favorite books from last quarter down below in the comments. Thank you so much for watching, and until next time, educate yourself, be kind to yourself, take care of yourself and others, and I will catch you on the flip side of the page.